So, we're going to start with no grip. I like this concept. Like, here, the higher level you go, you're going to have a grip. But also, depending on where you're playing, most jiu-jitsu folks are deficient in the takedown department. It's a real observation. That's why, like, when I realized a couple years in, I'm like, why aren't you guys teaching us any takedowns? Right? I feel totally deficient. I had, like, a little single and double that weren't good because I had to wrestle. And you go against anybody that has any takedown game, it makes all the difference when you don't, okay? So he's presented me back foot forward. What is going to work from that, right? So what I'm going to do, I attack the forward foot, right? I don't have grips. We're going to start addressing him getting grips on me in a minute, but we're going to do this. I'm going to explain this from three different ways, all right? One would be I throw. One would be he throws me with the same throw, or he comes in, I throw him with the same throw, right? And there's different sort of leg actions on this. That's all I'm talking about here. You see how he's like, that's this upper body, that's called off balancing. And John Donner uses a term a lot that's called kazushi in judo. He uses it for sweeps, he talks about it all the time, he's talking about jiu-jitsu, right? So, here I'm gonna step, I do this, okay? Now look, sometimes you see this throw like this. I'm gonna go down. Right? I just do this like a kickstart. Right? There's another throw where I did this on the front, and all I did was. So when I come in on it, here, right there, you got this, maybe an arm bar, the underbelly, side controls. Right? So that's just the basic entry book. I'm going to mirror his stance. I step, chest to chest, and I go down. You can do this motion. You can do this motion. We've got a fourth degree at our gym, and he is insistent, fourth degree in judo, on lifting them up when he comes in, right? He's like, that's how you do it. I'll tell you what, there's a lot of ways to do this one. When I just come in and go down his leg right here, like, watch. That's the most beginner way. That's the light level. Now, let's say Robert comes in, he steps it down, he comes in, does this on me, right? Yeah, just like this, right? I throw it first. That's the counter, right? So, if they are ever coming in on me, just come in for them, right? Yeah, that's fine. There's tons of entries. I do like, if I'm pummeling, you know, but in that instance, he can give me a two. And that's all you gotta develop is like, oh, I know that throw, and I also know that I can get him with that throw. He's trying to give me. All you have to do is be like, I see you coming in, and then you do it first. Right? So he has this forward. Right? I'm going to step. I'll balance there. He can go deep. Right? So I want you guys to both, you and your partner, develop a sense of timing on that. Of, I see here. Right? Now, there's one other version of this I want to mention. And these are called in judo atoshis. It means drop. That's the atoshi action. This they call a reap, a gari. That they call a hook, a gaki, right? This is different ways you manipulate somebody's leg, okay? Now if I'm in for here, what should I can do? I can drop to this knee, and you'll go down, right? John Donaher also has kind of popularized that version. And you can drop to either, right? I like dropping and keeping that leg when he falls in, right? So I can kind of, as I come in, I can drop here, right? So I can drop on that knee too. So that, forward is that one. It's fine either way, but here, after you drop, you can switch knees. So, and if you never done so, you may fall down on it. Also, you may want to use the big leg action, right? But just get in and play with this throw. It's like basically a warm-up because it's not a hard throw. I'm just coming in and throwing me, right? I'm going to come in, you throw me this time. Yep. Slapping the mat is good. Don't get your arm too far out, your elbow will hit. On your side, chin's up. Doubles the surface area you're falling on. Right? So, and then I come in and drop here, Alright, drop to that knee. Alright. You can also drop to the other knee. Here, you can just slide that leg down his leg. See, he's got this leg, he can turn you over with that, so you gotta sit through with it. Put your tongue in there. Alright. Matter of fact, we had a weird accident in the gym where his legs got hung up like this. Alright, if he pulls that leg, I had to kind of go.
You fired too hard.
Yeah, exactly. Too much lateral pressure. Mm-hmm. Right? So, I just always tell people, like, hey, in this situation, people do that. There's some escapes. I know a whole series of grappling, you know, Shimbri does off that, but if you step through to the head, you're fine. Right? So, this is the time you're going to want to. You just stop. That's all you do. And then this. Right? So, that's sort of the mechanics on that. Now, what I like about judo is very logical. What I mean by that is like, oh, there's an A and a B there. So, if that foot's forward, right, this is the A, we call it the major throw. He can kind of read it the same throw. This is the B, the minor throw. You probably, if you've seen any judo throw, what we're going to call is called osoda, right? That means major outside. This is called kosoda. It means minor outside. Both of them are on the back. See where my foot's at? That's not technically a foot sweep. That's another confusing kind of judo. That's a foot sweep. That's to be my foot on his foot. Right? If he's my foot on his leg, they call that a leg technique. So there's foot techniques, there's leg techniques. And they're a very minor distinction. Referees call it on placement like that and how people fall. They can look how somebody falls and go, oh, that was a wobble ball. Right? The action of their legs going through the air when they get thrown. Oh, I see, it's all that, and then it is what it is, what to score, okay? So, here's the thing. People will reach for this. They'll do it with their foot on the mat, inside or right. But I want you guys to start coming in here, right? You come in on that one for me, like just on that. But with your other foot, right? Yeah, see that? He catches me early coming in. You're gonna land here, so just build a habit when you land. Don't play in half court, right? Because it's talking to Andy's half court before we started training. It's a nightmare, right? Don't get stuck. It's a nightmare when you're on bottom too, right? So, but if I come in on Robert, my hook right here, he can go first. It's not gonna be identical throw like the last one, right? Right? Go ahead and put me on the right, right there, okay? I'm too late. Put your foot back on the floor. Right? It's got to be like here, or we're neutral. Right? And look, this is fine. See, I didn't quite get past him. He did good. He's like, don't put me inside. No. Or knee on belly. Watch what happens in this elbow. Like this. Maybe like with the TJ Brown syndrome, get arm triangles. Maybe you get an arm triangle. Maybe this is one of my favorite ways to mount. 10th Planet calls this the dope mount. I don't know why, as in it's a pretty dope way to mount somebody. Like that. A lot of times when you lay on him like this, Lovato teaches this too in his pressure passing. If I lay on him here and he turns his hips, it unwinds me in the mount. And look, I'm getting that chest pressure. So, big thing I wanted to do is like, hey, when you go against somebody that just got taken down, you can take them down. Where they're, you know, I'm coming on Robert, that's the first one, he hits me first. Right? He comes in and hooks the leg on the second one, I go first. So it's just a sense of timing thing. Like, when I was like a purple belt competing, I was like working on my takedown game all the time. And you know what happened? I got an IBJJF, spent $3,000 to go to California. I'll go. I'm about to throw this dude. I'm going to reach on close guard. Or you would pull guard. Like, there was no time. Here. So that's why I think it's good to have a counter game. Because they were getting hard on me as a counter. This dude's going to throw me. This dude's got grips. They went first. Somebody's coming to throw you, you go first. You got to know what throw counters what throw. Right? So just stand with that foot forward. This is the throw we're doing. This is called Osoda Ouchi.
then get some Tizukomuchi. Some Tizukosoto.
Osoto, you counter with Osoto. If I'm trying this on Robert, he can counter me the same one. Yeah. Right? With this one, he steps that leg on the outside.
Sorry.
You gotta get it first. Right? That was the sliding on us, but it did the same thing. Right, but it is very much, it's like if you've ever slid on ice, which I did at my grandma's house sometimes. It's like that. It's a unique feeling. I've only also felt when somebody hit a high level time, sweep, or throw on me where my foot got extended. It took longer than it should have. When you injure your knee, that happens a lot. They call it drop foot. You think your foot's going to hit the ground, it doesn't. Right? Like people with injured knees, torn ACLs, you plant and your legs stand back there, you got drop foot. It's like, but you think you're running. Right? So it's an interesting concept. Like, I want to give you that drop foot.
Sure, real slow. Okay. Counter, but that was really nice.
Okay, so look, I'm just going to pull him down like this. I was just doing this one. Okay, so let's step back with that one and then just step in and hook him. Right? And it's one of those that if you guys hook up and hop around like that.
So when you're hooking, he's on the outside, when you're hooking, you're bringing him to the inside.
He can hit it first. He goes backwards in the arc. Yeah, he's just going to kick back there.
Right then, pushing almost.
Yes, sir. So, look, again, you got to get as they're coming. Yeah. Or you got to like drill it very scripted, like, hey, I noticed that you're here, I could do this. That's how you can gain the timing on them. These are things that are timing. Again, oh, I noticed you were trying to throw me. I throw you. So he steps in. I'll post on his chest a little bit as I kick back. I'm just kicking back as soon as he starts going down, because he'll try and pull you down on top of him. So you got him. Which is a pretty common motion, right? Pass the guard, do that throw. We did a second ago. You can do that way. Right? So let's do that. 1, 2. I gotta go now. So, and there aren't wrong answers, but wrong answers are just other throws. That's how this works. Like, if you start, you know, trying to go that way with him, it's actually the highest percentage throw in all of Judo. For Judo, which you want.
You looking for the grip over here, Tom? Or just draw.
If I can get that, right. It's the inner thigh reap. We'll play with this a little bit in a minute for something else, but
yeah.
When I'm here, he has nothing right there. That's where I want to throw. Right? So watch. Just keep it. My foot is going to go like this. And my hands are going to go like that. So when he hooks me. Right? So some of you are kind of like, oh, I got this. And then you push him that way. He needs to go to where his leg was. There's like a vacuum over there. Like a hole. Throw him in. Alright?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's get 1, 2. Remember last weekend, TJ Brown was the UFC, and he showed this same technique from a wrestling perspective. This thing's orthodox for me. Most of you guys are instructed to a little bit, right? So it's not what we're doing, but I'm giving you an analogy, right? So 1, 1, 2, right? And after you stick this 2 here, right? So you blast into him like a double, but you're doing that same thing. One of the first takedowns I ever learned was. We're both here, and I'm not getting any grips, but here. And Marcello Garcia used to, he would do that and tap black belts with a knee bar after getting him. I've seen him do this to 2 people, right? And he taught, it's the most center I forget in my school, it's world champion Brazilian black belt. He taught at most seminars I had him in for. So this outside trip is a big thing, right? Judo, it looks a little different, but a Western has had a fight, a grappling match at some fights, like pre-fight stuff, and she both countered and got taken down with this. Because people don't have a takedown. I'm like, oh, I'm gonna do this. He got me, and it might look ugly like that, but you know what? 2 points. All right. Or if you're John Donner around, if you guys think his self-defense are coming out, he'll do something like that, so you can keep your teeth out, and then he's like, don't even think about throwing a punch so your feet are covered in blood. Right? So myself, and then it's like, I'm going to take you down and meet you in the face. Right? In Thai boxing, you see that a lot. They'll do little trips and stuff. And as the person falls, I didn't do that well. He must have been from a punch or something before he fell down. Right? But they will. They have a habit of kneeing people in the face as all to the floor on sweeps. Right? And I tell people, miss grips and sweeps when I'm doing that boxing are knees. Right? Some of the stuff we're doing in MMA, not some of the stuff we're about to do. Somebody does like this in the UFC, pull them back up and knee in the face. Like that's a great bounce I was watching him the other day. Black belt in Jiu Jitsu, legendary coach. And he's like, oh yeah, they can do that. Just pull them back up and knee. People are going to be putting their hands down all the time to base, to stop your takedowns, to just not get knee in the face. Right? If you know how to use your underhook, you can jerk them back up and get it. Right? But that's a little out of the rule set. But here's the thing. I follow you guys on that. I see some of y'all in the kickboxing class, the broadcast, y'all do your striking. I share one of the videos. It's good. Let me show the sort of traditional perspective on this. Okay? We're going to do robot judo dancing. Right? Just stand here. Alright? We're going to step with this foot. Just forward in that, just like we're. That's traditional. Let's do it with this side. Okay? Before that. Right? And look, that's the two throws that I taught. But it's the same little footwork caught for the other two throws that I mentioned. Right? So, here's a judo lesson. If you never get another one,
I love it.
Those are probably the two things that people that either do jiu-jitsu that want throws are going to go for. Like, I see it instinctually, and I see a lot of it coming from Nogi, like with the Whistler's Master's Nogi, and that girl trained in MMA, and the outside was very popular in MMA. It was just taught at a seminar I was at, and the first seminar I ever went to. It's a staple. Just like I said when I started, everybody's seen this. Has anybody not seen this? Exactly. The first seminar I went to, the same one, I'm like, I know these moves. I didn't know, right? But I've seen them. Like, they're in, like, I remember watching Andy Clark said, the TV show, Wild Wild West, had a lot of martial arts in it. It's like 67 when it was out. When I first started playing judo, I remember like an episode, and I was like, I watched this when I was a kid. I was like, that dude's doing judo, oh my god. That technique's called this and that.
Whose last name was West?
Yeah. Right, so that's that. Now let's get into a little different perspective. I think this is good for wrestling or MMA or jiu-jitsu.
Yes.
Right? So here, he gets my call. I'm gonna set this up from a few different ways, but we're gonna start here. Don't let anybody grab your collars first. You know they're gonna do some stuff we just did, right? Right? So go ahead and I go ahead. He goes to grab my collar. Don't even let him do it. I've developed that over time. But while you're developing that, don't let him get grip either. You gotta pop it off immediately to lift your hip. Right? A lot of people, I'm just going to call this two-on-one. Sometimes we play it here. You know, if you've ever done a single leg, it's pretty similar. I'm just doing that with his arm. But I'm going to move here. Okay? So, he grabs. I'm grabbing at his thumb here. That's kind of like lessen his grip a little bit. It's not like a wrist lock or anything. But then, too, we're kind of taking the slack out and his gi slip. Right? So, here. He grabs, you grab. Now this is real simple. See how I'm facing the window there? Let's see what's going on here. I'm going to turn and face. Instead of that blue giga, that blue giga. Alright? Sometimes that'll be my Robert initiative, like I'm going to be turtle. I'm going to go all fours, I don't want to hit my back. One of those two things will happen. I'll go turtle, take your back, I got behind your sleeve. Or if this one kind of roll out, just so you know what we're. See, and I can throw his hand down so it's not a weird fall, right? If he resists, just get outside on me. Yeah. And grab around my lap here. So this one will go here. And I step in front of me, and then turn around in a circle. Right? I got stuff too. But this will happen a lot. And yeah, you got other stuff you can do in slow percentage because I don't really expect to get taken down. Right? Especially with one like this. But, so what I'm saying with that is like, I feel like in takedowns when people do things like escape your mount, you don't see that coming typically. And we can work from that point with counters like I was saying earlier. So he grabs here, pop it off, drag it to your hip. Right here I'm facing this wall, I need to turn to face 180 degrees. I'm going to step in front, he's off balance.
Some sort of a back take will
be fine, or maybe stays turtle. And you just do this. Right? Be careful about putting your knee in the center. I train with people that will leg lock you for that behavior. Right? I bet some of those people are here. Anyway, like this. Okay? So, he grabs, and you can work this either side. Step in, but he's going to be off balance. This is the most beginner one we're going to do from here. Turn. Right? They're either going to fall to their back or they're going to go like this. It's less abuse on you if you do it 100 times in a day if you throw up. But realistically, you're going to have to work harder than that to put me on the back. And like we would resist that. So I need you guys to think about it both ways. Roll out, but also you're gonna do this. And that is explained to me, like some throws, they put the person face first into the floor. And that ends up becoming the knees and knees. If you do that 100 times a day, it can be part of your body. If you do like 1,000 reps in a year or something like that, right? So I would roll out of some of these, and that happens naturally too. We've been teaching this to our gym for a couple of weeks, right? So, anybody need to do it again?
One more time. All right,
sorry. He grabs. Step in. Turn. Kind of hybrided. We had a guy tap a dude once, like this.
Nice, I can see it.
It's heavyweights.
I've been there.
It's MacArthur.
What is it?
I think he tapped me from the last
time I wrestled. Just pump, like, but how about my arms going under his mat there? That kind of turned into both, like he hit, and then he's like, I'm gonna roll out of this. Sometimes you make those decisions.
400-pound wrestler, yeah, I mean,
yeah. Okay. 6'6".
You just tap.
Wingspan's
longer. Sometimes you just tap, you swallow his breath.
Just 3 weeks we can have
that. All right, let's work on that one, guys. Okay. Pop it off, and look, that becomes a sleeve that I have right here, okay? Boom. Also, like deep cross grips, I can kind of come in behind it anyway. It's like almost a little Americana pressure on his arm. It's not like perfect, but I did want to, like a lot of people have a slide by. They slid by his arm, right? Again, it's not perfect, but it's something you can do when somebody cross grips you if they don't have your sleeve also. But I was showing that from the same side across. If you grip cross grip, I'm gonna do it the same way. Same side hand on the thumb, this. We keep this because it's a good grip, okay? So watch what I was doing. I was stepping in, that's the off balance. He stepped, that's part of the off balance. It means he's stepping, and you throw him while he's doing that. So I step in, right? And I turn, and it's like, we start spinning around, and I'm gonna drag it down or whatever, okay? So that's one mechanic. That's a turning mechanic, okay? I think everybody can go ahead and start thinking about this in different directions. I'm just gonna run. Just go straight. Alright? He's facing that way. I'm facing this way. So his feet are gonna start doing that when I start walking across. Right? And I'll throw his hand sometimes if he wants to slide either way. He kind of rolls out. It's not a hard fall. We got mats. Right? Versus like straw back in the day. He grabs. Pop it off. So before we were turning, here, no leg action. Right? Got a front headlock, he's head standing or something maybe. Right? Here. Just go here. Right? He may stay turtle, he may roll out, just like the other one. But there I'm just walking him straight down. Okay? The second throw we did. Go ahead and step out of that. Okay? So when I'm stepping here, I'm blocking that foot. Right. If I could tangle his feet up, because he's stepping out. Right. Alright. It's all the same. But really it's a watch. You come in, you step in, I turn him 180. Or I keep going. Or maybe you are way up here. Which I've seen some of you do already. Right? I even saw some of you doing this. Like, oh, is he? Alright, he goes to step out. But he got P legs. Alright? So there. when I land, I land like this a lot if I go down on top of him. We need to feel comfortable when we go down on top of him versus being out of control and smashing. Right? Does that make sense? Well, think about he's holding on one of those, or trying to do all three. Walking down, turn him 180, or go foot sweep to walk in and down. Right? 1, 2. But when I get in with this, there's so many throw opportunities. Like, I worked over a dozen, personally. And some of these we had, we'll put this on our YouTube so you guys can watch it later. Right? Some of these, I already have a whole series of all the throws I like to do from here on our YouTube. Okay? So, when he grabs, I pop here. Be sure you're grabbing in his lap. Like, Kurt Austin always says, focus on the middle finger grip. Right? So you grab right there in his armpit. I haven't shown anything where I do this yet. Some of you are doing that. Good. I said there's no wrong throws. There's other throws. The only wrong throw is the one you get thrown with. Right? So, here. Now we'll start doing that since you guys are already doing it. Like that turn 181, I wasn't putting my leg between his legs, but we can. We did that on the throw earlier, right? The second throw we did when we counted. But watch right here. When I lift up, I'm like, oh, so I'm here to the outside. I'm just gonna show this from here. You guys keep doing your grips. I step in there. When he steps out with that, I go here. You go right down into a slider pass. Knee slice, whatever you guys like to call it. Right? See this hook I got here? Kind of expanding my chest. You will probably not get him with the chest arm bar, right? But you know what he will probably do? Retract his hand. Go ahead and retract. Now go to the American. This is an option. I'm looking for Simon. But I will always pull to set up an Americana in these situations. Okay? Which is a way we get out of the mountain when we go back to side control and we set that up, right? So he grabs here. So before I did this outside and then I just stepped past. We're talking about running past. We're talking about stepping in and turning 180. Now we're gonna step in between his legs and manipulate this leg here. That's called Uchimata, inner thigh reap. As he's adjusting for that, I go there. All right, watch that again. Everybody is already, I've seen everybody in the room do this already, so it's not new. You've been doing it, even though I didn't go over yet. All right, here. Here it tracks. Elbows on the mat, but also I'm trying not to crush Robert to death. Look up. I need to grab this or this. Right? That's the sort of Hicks and Gracie way he teaches it. People, I'm sorry, got good wearing the Chewy. Chewy teaches it this way. Mm-hmm. Right? Danny Drink teaches it that way, sort of old school. You see that in the Gracie Jiu Jitsu manual with Elio. Hickson does it this way. Motorcycle grips, what a lot of people call it. So you got, you know, palm to palm grips. Figure four grips, and you got wrist to wrist grips. They all can achieve the same thing with a lot. It's really important, I think. The Judo people are typically kind of good at this, to blend your submissions to your takedowns. They're there. People are already behind. Oh, I need to take it down. I need to deal with that. I'm going to submit you. Oh, I need to deal with that too, right? Thank you. Now, I like Corey and I have been playing a lot of chess because she likes that clean gambit, and now I have somebody to play chess with. But you know when somebody puts you in check and then they take you clean? That's Jiu-Jitsu. Everybody just uses the lazy chess analogy. Nobody knows how to play chess, but that's Jiu-Jitsu. It's like, when you use a piece and you make it to where like, I have to move my king to stay safe, and then you take my number one piece, that's Jiu-Jitsu. Alright, me hit you with the paint, now I'm putting you in check. You're dealing with that, well, I submit you. That's technically, right? Or that's technically, depending. Right, but if I can get you sliding down that slope of addressing things, like being out of your game, like, oh, I need to do this, I need to do that. No, you need to do your game. That's the name of the game, where you need to be like, oh, I'm not rolling out of what he's doing. I'm responding to what he's doing, not dealing with what I'm doing. When you're having to constantly deal with what the other person's doing, that's when you learn, you grow. But it's usually a little less fun to do, right? Unless you just enjoy the process, which I do. It's all good. Right? It's good. Like, I've had a hurt shoulder. We'll probably have to have surgery, unfortunately. Getting going through the process on it, so I've been rolling like this. Right? Big deal. I still am getting those wild blue belts in mass. Right? Edward's not one of them. He's sitting force. He's taking John's place. It's a matter.
Oh, good. Great.
Right.
All right. Every time he's one of those guys, man.
Too old. Too old.
Look. Here. I don't really do it this way with the figure four, but like I said, I just like to do the chewing.
I didn't get any dreams.
Yeah. But and that's like one of my coaches, it's like he does it away. It's like I think we should all do the acknowledge all of them. You know, Andy will probably even Robert and I will probably all maybe
sometimes
do
sometimes I will let do a relaxed grip, but it's usually a
sometimes I do the bicep one.
You know, Mike does the bicep one too.
Yeah.
Right? But I think it's a preference thing and like you know,
it's a body type preference. It's a lot of things that how you
like out of cases. Sometimes I'll slide into it. You know, as they're escaping, I'll notice I'll be grabbing the bicep one
for sure. And I think like with us three, we've all coached Jiu Jitsu athletes, been Jiu Jitsu athletes, and when you do that as an activity, you acknowledge like, oh man, you might do it differently than you know Brian and Robert. But man, I love the way he does it or whatever, right? Like. Everybody, I noticed that early on with like myself, Motley, and Linker when he was there, would all do the arm triangle different grips sometimes, different positional finish when we were getting them to tap. Well, all had a different flair. And the way that both of them did it did not work for me. But I taught all of them, right? So it's just have an open mind. I used to have a bad habit when I was younger, starting out, white blue belt, you know, I don't have time for this technique, we should just be rolling. This is stupid, I'm never gonna use it. You know, and then I got tapped with that same technique I was talking shit about so many times. I learned, I'm like, oh, there are no man, I better be aware of all the techniques because I'm going with people and they don't train me. They do that technique and like they're good at it. And I was just off the crack about it.
You gotta learn the stuff you don't like so
yeah.
You know how to defend.
Yeah, because you guys might hit me with it and I'll be surprised. And that's again, you don't wanna be in that element. Unless you were like, oh, here I am, I had to drive for this. That used to be me, I used to have to drive to get these situations, like 2 hours one way, come up here train with Andy for his events and stuff, because I knew, man, he doesn't do things like me, right? I'm going to learn. I'm going to get uncomfortable. And it is something that's just as important as anything else we'll do here, is to grow under
part of your mental growth, because you do get the same anxiety going to a new gym a lot of times as you do go to tournaments and other things, because you're going to roll afterwards usually.
That's why
it's a good way for molding as part of how Jiu Jitsu molds.
Yeah, put yourself out there.
Yeah.
Be uncomfortable. You know, as I was saying, like this is a side. I mean, most people like I've trained cross trained forever, but I went to Westside for the first time ever last week, right?
Yeah.
And it's not like but it and there are like 60 people there, but I was like, hey, well, Rudy, what's up, TJ? We're having a good time, right? But it wasn't intimidating for me, but some people it would be. Like at that time, and like some people would avoid situations like that, and it was good. But it's like it was out of the norm. It was out of the comfort zone. It was out. And I was fine. I had a great time, right? Because some people that whole idea that would keep them out of the practice here, right? So yeah, play with this a little bit. I'm gonna show one more thing from standing, and we're gonna go ahead and switch it up to the floor. Okay, just hit 1, 2. Just pummel over under. Yes. Right, go to grab my collar. Arm drags. Arm drags from over under. Arm drags from just like he goes to grab. Pretty good idea to grab higher on arm drag than it is at the elbow. Because you grab the elbow, he can drag you too. Alright. In the gi classes, we've been doing one of those. Alright, but we've been training all three of those. Right? So think about it. Here's another one. Alright, grab my head like a wrestler would. Do that again. You gotta go. You gotta react. You like keep going. Arm grab. You're pummeling. Arm grab. Right. So I just wanted to point that out. We don't have time to do all of this. Right. But now I'm just gonna get from the outside here. Okay. So we did outside. Outside. Okay. We did where we went inside. Inside. You can go, and I haven't shown this one yet, but you can do it, and I saw several of you do it. Right. You can go inside, outside. That's just tying all of it together. Now, we're gonna make a free throw combination. You're gonna go outside, inside, or inside, inside, ankle pick. Anybody ever seen an ankle pick? You like it? One of my favorites. I've hit it a few times in tournaments. It's a good technique. We had a guy who grapple on the same card as Alyssa that hit it against a more experienced guy in a match recently, a couple weeks ago. Okay, so look, I go here, here, and he's gonna step out of that. And there, here we are in this sort of position where we were throwing from earlier, where I can be here. This is dangerous. I felt like Robert might have said, you'll hook me right there or something. Yeah, right? You gotta be careful about like standing up next to their hip. I'm always looking for that, right? But you gotta kind of, I'll stand at your hip. If you get your knee behind me, you might break me over. Right? So here, look. Outside, inside, and hip. Right? You gotta be watching for it. One more time. I'm gonna go inside, inside this time. So go inside, inside, and hip. Turn into single leg. Then I'll go down, don't worry about it. So you're playing single legs now, right? Last note, if you do land in leg drag, don't do that, or he'll leg lock you also, right? Just triangle your legs, pivot with your knees up. Outside your hook, maybe. Maybe you want to roost it, or inside. Again, I'm not quite prepared for that, but that's an error I see people make, and that leg drag, when you drop down, it's like, this sort of guard pass, the white ball. Be sure you have that component here. A few times we land here, okay? So as he's stepping out of that second inside throw, he grabs his ankle. Right, I was telling Andy, one of the guys who black belt, or jiu-jitsu black belt too, was making them step after they stepped out of the first one, drawing forward to catch the long move. Slide on ice, right? That too, they were kind of getting that, right? But anytime you're stepping out, that ankle pick's a great follow-up. It gets you working a lot of different attacks, and we're now we're doing three techniques at once. Maybe you hit the second one, the first one when you're going for a lot. Maybe you got to dig deep into all of these, right? So let's do it once. And why doesn't do anything? Sort of, right?
Why doesn't do many? But they can be a little harder. I remember when I was a white belt, the day after I got promoted to blue belt, actually, I got thrown on my shoulder. The first judo seminar I ever attended, broke my collarbone, went on to get a white belt, right? Most white belts, if they broke their collarbone, would stop training, right? And I'm not saying I'm special, I was just more like, I should get a white belt and this stuff that broke my collarbone, right? But there's a couple of bigger throws that I don't think that are for everyone, but they can be true killers. And I will make sure that you hit the ground nicely, and you might want to think. You just think about setting up the 10, I will throw your hand down for you. You might not see how you're going to hit the mat, but I won't throw you fast or hard. But it's probably a throw you haven't been looking for. Right? Feels weird till I turn you over. Exactly. Right? Here's another thing. Jump over that. I hate it. Right? So if I'm in here like this, go above his knee and jump over that. Right? Same thing. I did this incorrect on this single for a long time. I would go here and he'd jump over. I still have his leg, but then he might get out of the other setup. That's why you do it that way. And look, we're landing kind of hearing that little mount transition again. So, those are just a couple of hip throw variations. That first one we did when we went here, that is a Greco-Roman hip throw. That's where I got that throw, right? The very first one started with the turn 180. The rest of it is kind of some sort of a judo, sambo, Russian 2-on-1 hybrid system, right? Like a lot of good stuff in there. I got a lot of it from judo, I got a lot of it from jiu-jitsu. And then it's like MMA ground. It's like more no-gi centric. Right? Think about Greco-Roman. There are no legs. Right? I can't touch your legs. I can't use my legs. It's upper body. Right? So to
really interesting. So that's why with the no-gi stuff, we've been doing more of this off the tongue. Right? So, any questions on the stand-up before we move on? Let's get started. Well, we're just going to start having butterfly. I want to make some comments about how you might get butterfly. This is not going to be a seminar on entry, so I'm going to show a couple of things. Okay? Put me in that real quick. This is an entry we've been doing. And if he's postured up, I want his hands on the floor. If his hands are already on the floor, but like we usually work from. That's a good one. Yeah, it's a real good. It's in a lot of the 10th planet. We've been doing their warm ups like a year. Throw flow drills. We do them as part of class, right? What you know, and it complements. We're doing butterfly right now. Marcello Garcia, big butterfly player. Also, guys, Andy and I used to train with Nova Uniao. They had sick butterfly bar. Shaolin, Hobson, Runo. I just trained with Runo like 18 months ago and it was butterfly bar. Right? Hobson would send up this way, right? He's gonna come in and he plays like this. This is like, so when I was coming up and I was only getting influenced by these guys, these black belts from Nova, they played this way. And I'm just telling this joke, like we've been doing Marcello's butterfly bar. Right? And so this way, right? So I grew up in Jiu Jitsu thinking like, oh, there's single and double butterfly. But Marcello does it this way, and a couple of times I've seen him do this in techniques. He calls it half butterfly. Right? The Nova guys call him this half butterfly. That's what Bruno is doing. Right? So that's going to be the perspective of this class is sometimes you sweep from here. Sometimes you see from here. I call it single double butterfly. This is single. Because this is not really doing anything. This is double because now both my feet are doing something. Right? They don't need to just be chilling here. They're like this. Right? They need a little bit of connection when you're going to get your techniques. That way, if he tries to kick back or something, I can follow him. Right? Whatever I want to do. Okay? So, again, this is not going to be on entries. This is going to be. I want you to be able to troubleshoot when you start doing the basic sweeps and they go wrong, right? So we're gonna do a real basic entry we've been doing. That first escape I ended up here, okay? If Robert tries to pummel one side into an underhook, okay, I wanna catch that side. So we're coming here, he pummels like this. See, I'm to my side. I'm not on my back. If I sweep him here, didn't even land on my back. So what happened here, guys? Sometimes that happens. So you gotta do like when we were throwing on those inside techniques and you pass as you sweep them. A lot of times, like you get to play with higher level guys. Like, oh, I realized you were taking me down, so I started replacing my guard before I hit the mat. Same thing on sweeps. That game players are gonna start retaining guard during your technique. My wife's one of the world's worst at that. Her butt hits the mat, she's already out. Right? Like, it's. She starts fighting, like, deer in the sweep. Like, nah! Right? So, we're just gonna do this basic, and we're gonna start like, he does this, he does that. He starts giving me levels and layers of resistance I have to overcome. This is just the basic sweep. Here, he pummels. Like, there, I landed past his legs in side control. I have an underhook. We're going to do some different grips later. If you don't have an underhook and you're going to side, you got to get one. Okay? Now, you can sweep to knee on belly. And I think for some of you in the room, you three, you, maybe you, maybe you. This will be good because of your body type. Because of how long you are, and probably Robert too, in comparison to the other grapplers in the room, right? Not saying like, but like people, I see people being on 5'8 and under being really good sweep. Marcello Garcia being one of them, right? If you do it this way, what will happen is you will land a knee on belly. So I want you to think about positional follow-ups and how you end up. So if we're here, four points.
Yeah.
Once I get my 3 seconds of knee on belly, 2 points to the sweep, 2 points to the knee wrap. Okay. So, You know, get in, start with your body lock. Keep pommels right here. I push his knee out. I have a guy, Jeff Woods, just got promoted to black belt. One of my longest running students was my history professor, mentor while I was in college. He's always done the sweep. Always. It's one of his jams.
It's one we learned back in the MMA days and things.
Yeah. Marcello has some great MMA variations, and like most of the stuff that we've been doing for his stuff is from no-gi, whereas the Hobson stuff is gi. I got the old Hobson fusion. They've been going over that a lot, right? But, so, if he's like got a good, like heavy base, you don't feel like you're gonna uproot him, that. If you are the, and I think if you're the shorter grappler, this is really good. For me, I got kind of scoot back a little bit. Right? I've never leaned towards this because I'm usually the longer guy, right? But I think it's really good. Marcello always uses this. Like I'm talking 90% of the time he's doing a technique is this. You guys might have seen Gordon Ryan. Marcello's the first person to make this famous. Right?
Seen Gordon Ryan shoulder crunch like.
Yeah, that's that, right? But that's like how Marcello teaches it with the knee push. But yeah,
same
Gordon calls it shoulder crunch sumigation. Sumigation.
He might teach it with the hook and the knee from the outside with the heel.
I do. How like a scissor sweep?
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's
I do.
How I've always
done that's
it.
How I
did the single, well, you thought of a single butterfly with one leg down so that I can always lift, and then when the knee posts, I'm pulling the knee out.
And I think coming from like, here's where I would always get that one, like escaping side mount. Like I would get one knee in, I'd go pull through, you get guard, and my other foot would get hung.
Yeah,
right?
Get that one, yeah.
So again, entries dictate what you're gonna be able to do. Some of the times when I get butterfly guard, I escape, so I'm flat on my back. We'll address that here in a moment. When they start shutting down the sweep with their hands and stuff, we'll do something called a reshoot, where we just sweep them again, right? So, basic idea here, he pummels. I'm going there, I'm just falling to my side. I've got this, right? And if it's hard for you to like draw him off of his base, this is a really good one. If you're the shorter grappler, this is a really good one, okay? Now let's think he stands up here in the sweep. Right, so go ahead and come back down. When I start sweeping you like this, stand up there. Right, so that can stifle you. Right, what you've got to do is use this. Come back down. Here, I'm gonna dust a little bit section real quick. So look, we do this in the warm up sometimes. Right, so you're here, you're falling on your side. That's your raising leg. Watch what this does. That's what's going to get him to go over if he posts on not the leg you're raising with, right? You've got that one kind of controlled. It's that other one. So you got his upper body. You got this. You're falling. We're going to do that. Okay? So here he pummels. I'm going to go here. Start standing up. And I might be side control. I might get knee on belly. I might follow his leg and go to mount. If you sweep him out, and this will happen a lot, pinch your knees. You gotta do that. It's simple. Okay, I'm gonna just do the basic first straight approaches to mount. Okay, so I'm going in here. So I just build it into the sweep. Okay, so. So I pummel in, just do the basic, we'll fall to your side. Yep, good. Oh, I'm gut there, so go ahead and clear the leg. Nice, good, back to your body lock. All right, I pummel in, this time push my knee out. So, yes, all right, good. You can get it on the thigh or the knee. Marcel does it both ways, all right? This time I'm gonna start standing up with that. You just use the live toe. Alright, so you're here. I like this off the pommel, super basic. Because if I get this and I start clapping Robert this way, is that we'll do something else with that, right? But he starts sweeping me. Nice, good. I like how you applied that concept in. It's not about my foot, basically. Right. Kind of caught it, man. Right? So. Right, you covered my foot with your foot?
It was lower down by the shin.
Yeah. Yeah, that's fine. You gotta, people are gonna start seeing, when you have really good sweep, the last thing they'll be able to do is stand up with their unguarded leg. And you gotta deal with it. You still gotta sweep them. I was like purple belt. Bradford. He gave John a private lesson one day. John's like a new blue belt. And he's talking about that live toe detail. I was like,
what?
Bradford's. Yeah, he's good, right? He's out in trained Greg Jackson for years, lives out in California, right? But did a seminar several years ago at our place, and it's great. He's taught a bunch of Dave Collin stuff. He's a Higson's
retired Secret Service guy.
Yeah,
he owns Secret Forces or Special Forces or something.
He's a guy that guarded. So, he's great too, if you don't know, there's a bunch of nuclear warheads that go around the interstate at all times. Yeah. He guarded those in this part of the country from like Amarillo, Texas to Arkansas. Out of Fort Smith. But guys, play with that. Push the knee out, base the sweep. Don't fall to your back. You will not need to be hard. You'll have to do other things. Like we're kind of chatting about how you do that if you're on your back, right? Or you're gonna have to do that live. So you're gonna have to sweep them and go. Maybe fall them out. Think also about, am I ending a side mount, knee on belly, or full mount? Right. It's going to be one. You might also have to pass their guard. Okay? So, everybody's sweep will be a little different, but that's what I want. I want you guys to get it with the troubleshoots. Okay? One, two.
Okay, that troubleshoot in. Go ahead. Here you go. Save you. Wait till I start moving clear both your feet at the same time.
Yeah. You don't want to stay there long, right?
Correct. I wait till you just give me the response. So, guys, we'll start doing a troubleshoot.
It's a different thing you do if you're kind of off to the side, right?
Okay, so I'm here, he pummels, right? I need to get that. Even when I get that, he may still close to the side. Right? If this happens, sit back up, reach you. Okay? Like, I've been teaching in our classes. Go hands on my biceps, push me down. We've been starting from here. You know, some people like to pass butterfly, right? Right. You can grab in a geek by the armpits there, pull the armpit hair out. That'd be terrible. But watch here too. You can sit up and I can sweep here, and he's got all the there. Right. So I just sit back up again. Right. But he starts like that's how you overcome the levels of resistance. There, I started flat, set up, he posted. Sent back up again and got him the third try. Right? So, most people that I train in the room with, are like, they hit that first level of resistance and they lose in the roll. Right? Like, my speed just didn't work. Maybe it could have. You can salvage it late into like, think like some guards you naturally think about it that way. Like, I'm just doing something else to guard. Butterfly is a type of guard where you, a lot of times, can get repeated attempts. Guards where you have inside control, inside their legs, there's a lot of options. Okay, so sit up and sweep. Sweep them, they post, let them post. Sit up, re-sweep. You gotta get that elbow punched. Why? Even Hobson has this big thing where he goes over about, it's like, you know how people put out a video series and they got like number techniques? He got a whole one where he just talks about that. Now, don't, you're gonna do this. Don't let him do that. You gotta do this. Marcello has a hole in his book and a hole in his video, right? So they've taken the time to go, this is something in and of itself, right? Of getting that elbow correctly. But we don't always have to. If he set, just set like real, like, but like kind of back down here. I can't get underhooks here. Right? So then it becomes like I might try to sweep from here, maybe here. But look where his hands are. I start trying to sweep here. Right? Switch sweeps. Right? Now I'll apply that concept side, side, side. I just keep going. I keep sitting back up. He's gonna, alright, I was in here and his hands on the outside too close. Doy stop. Sit back up. Oh! Boom, and stay close. You sit back up. We call it the reshoot. Right? Like a wrestler, You're like, oh man, he shoots it again. Reverse. Sweeps. Sweep doesn't work, do it again. Doesn't work, do it again. Do it on the other side. I did some different grips in that last exchange. We'll get to a little bit of that, alright? But think about the concept of the reshoot. And maybe switching sides if you are like color belt or feel comfortable with this stuff already, okay? 1, 2. Primarily in showing you a grip like this very common elbow. Or working from the body lock. There's a few techniques you can do from here, okay? So, this is, it's over 100, but look how I got his elbow here versus here, all right? And I'm gonna do some stuff at the very end where I come in here, right? So we will do some stuff with that. So think about that, the importance of controlling the elbow, right? Now, if you post, I'm gonna go to this other grip that I like to survey, like, what's everybody call this and why? Marcello calls this one mechanism the club. Like, basically slapping somebody in the air. I don't like it a lot. but then he does this like this. Right? He slaps them in the air. And when you can't get an underhook, it's really solid. So what I say earlier, if you sweep somebody and you don't have an underhook and you sweep the side control, you got to get one. People will scramble out. Especially people like Robert, right? And anybody can, right? Oh, he doesn't have an underhook, I'm gonna get out. Right? If you're gonna get side control, you almost always have to have an underhook. You gotta have the transition for when they get the underhook, which is another thing, right? So I'm gonna try just the basic sweep in the several groups I'm seeing, like you're doing it this way. And I'm not saying that that is 100% wrong. I'm saying that sometimes people put their hand up. I'm also saying that should not stop what you're doing. So if I sweep here, he puts his hand out, I sit back up, like this. And I did the club sweep on the other side. Okay? So that's what I call a switch sweep. I can try one way, I sit back up, I could do it the other way. I could do it the other way and do the other grip. Right? But I'm gonna do it one way and sweep the other. I'm gonna do it this way. I'm gonna sit back up and switch my grips and sweep it the other way. That's the way we can work. Different grips, different sweeps, all on the same. Right? So one more time here. This one I've been teaching our crew from right here. Because sometimes, like, hey, look, everybody I study shows the sweep where you sweep them here. But a lot of times, you post. So sit back up. And here. That's the very first throw I showed you guys. Is that. I didn't show grips on that a lot of times. Pushing your point, make sure that we do it with the butter. Right, so sweep on one side with the over-under, leg post, sit back up, sweep on the other side with the clubbing grip. Dan Plant calls it the clubbing grip. Marcello just says, what? Club. Right? you remember Jerry Lorenz?
Uh-huh.
He trains with Johnny now. As far as I know, he was in Conway or did. Marcello Garcia Black Belt taught some camps and stuff we went to. And he would train, and he would just slap you in the air. Right? Then maybe I like to use like that clinch. I could use clinch for kickboxing or MMA. Boom! I do like that versus the ear smack.
Like a blade.
Yeah, like a knife or a chain or whatever you call it, right? One time I'll say this, Nate Murdoch is drilling with the group and his palm of his foot hit my ear and perforated my ear. I had problems with it for like 5 years. Right? So I don't like slapping people in the ear unless I'm like really one of the boxers, you know? Right, because you know how you get stuck there, that'll happen. And I think that it's really good. It's like, I don't have to tell myself to not slap you in the ear in the tournament. I'm just like, oh, I slap you in the ear. And just, maybe I want to slap Andy. I like that dude. You know, Robert, I want to slap you in the ear. I just do this. It won't feel as good. I hit an artery with my bone. But at least your ear won't be ringing.
Yeah, you won't be slapped.
Right?
That's a little less disrespectful.
Stop work slaps. Cyborg straight
up slaps. Cyborg also gets DQ'd against Paul Ryan. And for that, but that it's a great point. And, yeah. You know, I think that part of it's psychological. Like, if Robert signed me here, I'd be like, what are you doing, dude? Right? And then, what he did what I was talking about earlier. I don't should be thinking about Robert signing me here. He's sweeping me. Right? Yeah. He took me out of my thought process. Like, I don't need to be thinking about him slapping me in the ear. So it's one of those things that adds a leg away or to like taking me out on. And not everybody does that, right? But if you get slapped in the ear, you just be like, oh, wow, I know what this is. Don't worry about it. I can say my ear ring, I'll be good. Okay? So, sweep from one side of that post, sit back up, and you're doing for this on the other side. Okay? Not this. Make sense?
Yes, sir.
Point to anything in the guard. You know, we were studying why I've mentioned Donner several times since I've been here, is we were studying his leg locks for 6 months. In our advanced class and in our regular class. And he has a big section over birth. You know what? None of the stuff we did today. Right? So it's a complex guard. It is a guard that works very well being the that works in different leg positions, single, double, half leg. Okay? So I mentioned this. Okay? If I'm just here, or maybe Robert is like pushing there, I can grab his sleeve here and I can push it between his legs. So this is a little different style. The other stuff I'm showing you, I like knee and no gi. This is gi specific. Same on my head. All the same mechanics. Okay? Maybe I want to do this slide. So I'm not going to be able to push his knee. But, so look here. Right, I already have the underhook. So, when I'm thinking gi play, I'm thinking different ways. So if I'm going to play that offset single butterfly, and I'm thinking about different ways I'm going to control this arm. That's what I'm saying. Let's look at some other ways. When I start pulling Robert's sleeve to push in between his legs, he might retract it back. Okay? Now, if we've seen one trend here, this seminar, it's that people don't want to get swept. I don't want to get swept. If I was to start trying to sweep you, what might you do? Oh, sorry again. But I'd be able to pull back, take out of it, right? It's going to be sort of a scramble, but he had his arm free. He said, I'm going to start getting out with that, right? So if I'm trying this knee grip here, he retracts it back. I use this in half of more than I use it here, to be perfectly honest, okay? Get wisdom in here. He may do this. And I like doing this when he does this, right? There's another little mechanic. Right? I'll do it this way too. That's the way I often. Right? So like from the get, pull it out. Here. If he's deep wizard, he might not get his arm. Right there's that sort of submission right there where I just like put you down on the wrist bone because you're not my friend, but you are.
I appreciate that.
So, just think about it. Don't do it.
Okay, so, I'm just going to do the basic sweep. So, I punch between the legs.
Punch his arm between his legs. You're doing this kind of, look at his arm squatted up there like that. Okay? If he just holds onto your deep pants, don't do that. It'll go with you if you're really like, dropping leg down on it, dedicated to it. I'll pull it with me. Doubles both, right? Like, do that and pop up on all fours. Or pop up on these, like on your feet, sprawl out basically. Like you're gonna do it with these like that. Right? And hope retain that if you can. So, right? That's fine. He's putting his hand out because you're gonna get swept, right?
Yes. Yeah,
right? But, it is. But here's the thing.
We know what to do in that close thing. Is another cool thing about it, right?
So, there's that, there's this, or there's this. If you ever start sweeping and he puts his hand on the mat, that's what I want him to do. You're about to.
Maybe an armbar. I stay on my side for this armbar.
Look how much area you have to here. And two, when I do this, all my weight's on his body. But a back take is really, really a solid move. Because a lot of times they're going to use this and start sweeping them. Okay, so play around with that. that's just like some perspective on here. Versus here. Push his leg between his arm, trap his arm like this, or maybe wrap his gi up around his arm. Some of that's gi specific, I realize, right? But I like using that against you if we're gonna have it on. Right? Maybe I just like cover your face with my gi. Whatever. Right? Anything, right? You just use it. Use what you got. So, one more. Basic sweep, punch his hand between his legs. He starts pulling his hand back. Wrap over his elbow. Herky starts pulling his hand back. Trap. You either sweep him by doing this. That kind of it ends up in a weird spot. Like this. Like a wrestler position. Some people, to avoid that oddness, I don't care, I'm gonna do it anyway. He posts his hand. You're good. See how you slap? Rear mount would have done this a lot. We just started getting into arm direction butterfly, and which we're doing all this sort of follow up back takes. Right? Which is just another direction on all this. Today's thing was like sweeps. Okay? So, just play with that single butterfly, some different thoughts on the arm from that than all that other stuff we do. That's the sort of theme. It's like people are going to use the other leg, the other arm, maybe this arm. You're sweeping them that way. Just stop. They should have to work very hard if they're going to stop your techniques. And you should be developing your techniques. So it's like, I knew that they were going to do that. So I did this. All right, let's do it. Come up here for years. When we're going in town, I was like, that's where it used to be. All right, over by Abby.
Yes, right.
I was like, I don't remember where it was, what happened. I was at that one too.
Yeah, you right? Were at that one too.
But it's been great. Robert comes up and trains. I can say these guys stand the same. Right? It's just because I've known the whole time I've done martial arts standing. Right? So it's a privilege to come up and just train with you guys. And if you ever want to come here to me, I mean, Robert's been up, Eddie's been up.
Me and Brian started white to black together, so it's surreal sitting here where we're the black belts watching all the white belts, because literally we were exactly where everyone were from the very first day white belt to black belt.
I was hanging out the way up here, man, when you told me you're coming.
It's just surreal. I just had that little surreal moment, like, man, this is.
It is. It's
we're getting a little long in the tooth when we start seeing that.
This will tell you how long ago, maybe I've been trying it, not, but. The first time we met each other, we coached up to our Hobson and Morrison. And then you changed to kickboxing with Willie.
Yeah, I didn't do kickboxing, but.
Exactly, but we still did it. And we did the hogs of 1-4 boxing.
Yeah, I remember those hardcores that learned us bar hard and stuff.
I was like,
I don't do
that.
I'm a wrestler.
Dude, I do Jiu Jitsu, man.
That's what I'm doing.
I'm just trying to help Willie out.
Okay, speaking of Willie, I learned this from Willie. Willie is someone I trained with extensively over years, William McLaughlin.
Bryce Mitchell was an original coach.
And Rudy and I were, his son, were drilling at the TJ seminar, right? TJ just sent me a picture of us, Rudy and I, with him just 7 weeks since I've been here, right? So, Willie called this the deep drill. If everybody can get where they can see, what I'm doing is I'm coming in here and I'm grabbing the deep.
Cross side of the belt?
Yes, reaching across, right up under here. Now, it's not going to be my hand that's choking him on this side. It's just going to be the down. Like look at all that slack in his knee. We're going to take that slack out. I'm going to be giving you details I learned from my friend Jack Toffer, tied in with Willie's entry. There's just a few things where I started doing the chokes differently the last couple years that make them, like, my hands are involved less. I'm using less pressure. I don't fatigue out my forearms, et cetera. Okay? So, you know, we were playing everything here was an underhook today, right? We did that one time, right? I mean, that's from standing. This is like he has an underhook. Catch there. Start falling back to your side. Here. Okay? Now, notice I created a little space. See this distance here? Now, some people will leave their foot like on the kidney area, right? Some people will throw it higher. But regardless, it's this pinching of my knee that does a straight arm lock.
I like this because sometimes here he could get his head back up. Yeah, and there's just things you can do with this. Here, and he could still get his head up here, but if I point my knee like that to the floor, try and get your head up. Sorry. Right? But that, it's very tight. It's very tight. Okay? So, but like other than just getting his head up, Robert can do a few things. Yes, perfect. Perfect. That's actually what I want. If he goes the other way, it's an omoplata, which I don't want to go over today. That'd be too much to cover. So here we got straight arm lock. Right? And if he starts flying back into my guard here, it's two mechanics. The posture break and a sit-up. Your elbow does not do this. That is wrong. You don't do that. I don't do that on any choke, period. Doesn't mean you will never do it. I'm just saying I don't personally use any chokes where I do this. Elbows are tight. Pull him in, sit up. Effortless, right? That was a good blood choke, right? So here he gets an underhook. I'm going here, create a little space. Straight arm lock. You guys start doing this, he's gonna hate it. Because it's tight and he can pull back in. Grab, pull him down as you sit up. Everything's pulling in, right? That's part of my sit up is I'm pulling him in. I'm also pulling him down with my legs. That's just legs. This is just here. Your legs are pulling him down onto your arms. That. Literally, I love this because it's effortless. Randy, one of our black belts, and I did a private with Jack Toffer, who's a dude that's worked extensively with Dixon over the years, like private lessons at his house. And that's it. He's just like, what I wasn't doing for years is the crunch. I was all, just pulling him in, and I've also been guilty of raising my elbow like that. You don't have to do that if you know everything you're doing. And like the bag is, like everything's in tight. If I start doing this, it's not in tight. I'm not using my whole body. Think like when we're in tight, like when we're doing our Americanas and stuff, everything's in tight, right? So on this cross choke, that's the best way I know how to do it. I've been telling my students, like I wrote a master's thesis on martial arts history. I teach history at a college. And Kano, the guy that did a judo, set judo up everywhere. Everywhere. This is a picture in 1933 of him training the German army, right? Yeah. He sent it to France, and in his diary, he's like, these people lifting their elbows on the choke. Like laughing at him. Like, these people don't even know how to choke, right? And he's like, they were doing this. Like, you don't do that, right? It's here. It's a downward pull. Like, almost like, right? I can pull down, sit up, and you're pulling them down, too. You just have to guard. Posture all over. It's this. That's how I'm doing my legs. You have this. Right? I always like to, it's almost like that club sort of idea. That immaterial here, some people would show like doing a thumb in the collar. This is the easiest for me to grab. See, there's like three little places I can grab right there. I like to go over here. I sit up. Cross choke, overhook, cross choke. Does that make sense? Last technique of the day. Let's do it. 1, 2.